MedCram.com.
Welcome to another MedCram COVID-19 update. Today we're going to talk about vaccine efficacy. I think that's an important topic given the current situation at hand where we're talking about vaccine efficacy and whether or not it's waning. There's some data out of Israel that seems to indicate that this might be the case. They've already approved booster shots in Israel for those over the age of 60. And in this country, as you recall, a number of people were vaccinated over the age of 75 at the beginning of this year in January and February. And it's been about 8 months since that time. So the question is are we seeing a waning of vaccine efficacy in the United States? To what degree is it going? And exactly how efficacious are the different vaccines that are approved, the Pfizer-BioNTech, the Moderna, and the Johnson & Johnson vaccine? How efficacious are they against specifically the Delta variant? We've seen a lot of efficacy studies prior to Delta, but the real question at this point, since Delta seems to be just about everywhere in the United States, is how effective is it against Delta? So let's take a look at this study. This was published in the CDC Morbidity and Mortality Weekly Report, and it's titled Interim Estimates of COVID-19 Vaccine Effectiveness Against COVID-19 Associated Emergency Department or Urgent Care Clinic Encounters and Hospitalizations Among Adults During SARS-CoV-2 B1617.2, and that's the Delta variant, predominance in 9 different states from June to August of 2021. Now, again, no small study. There was 32,000 medical encounters, 187 different hospitals, 221 different emergency rooms and urgent cares. And this was done in a representative 9 states: Indiana, New York, California, Colorado, Utah, Minnesota, Oregon, Wisconsin, and Washington. It started in each of these areas when the Delta variant was 50% or more in the cohorts that they tested for. And they looked at vaccine efficacy and used a model to adjust for age, geographic region, calendar time, virus circulation, results within the surrounding counties, at the facility, on the date of the event. And it was weighted for inverse propensity to be vaccinated or unvaccinated. They're looking at the vaccination status in the community, the number of people coming into the hospital or urgent care or emergency room that are vaccinated, and then they're actually testing for it. And the way they defined their cohorts in terms of vaccinated or unvaccinated was, to be vaccinated, you had to have the Johnson & Johnson shot at least 14 days before the medical encounter, or if it was the Moderna and the Pfizer vaccine, the second shot had to be at least 14 days before the encounter. And that's for good reason. It's because that's when we start to see the highest levels of vaccination. And that's not a change in the definition. Of course, the unvaccinated were those that had no doses whatsoever. If there were people in between that, let's say they had their second dose within the 14 days, or if it was the Johnson & Johnson, a shot within 14 days, they were excluded from the study. So we don't have that gray zone there of whether or not they were developing immunity or not developing immunity. It's just taken out of the equation so we can have a clean study. So let's take a look at this graphic. And the first thing that we're going to look at here is COVID-19 hospitalizations. And again, what they're doing is they're looking at discharge summaries, which are COVID-19-like in terms of their hospitalization. So they came in with some respiratory issue, perhaps there was a pneumonia on the chest x-ray, etc. They broke it down into the unvaccinated as the reference and the fully vaccinated as the intervention group here. And so you can see here that in the population, you would imagine if there's a lot of people that are vaccinated, that you're going to have fairly similar amounts in terms of who's coming in vaccinated versus unvaccinated, and how are they coming in terms of respiratory ailments. And then they checked their SARS-CoV-2 and the percent based on what are in this row. So in other words, of the unvaccinated group that came in with a COVID-related illness or COVID-like illness that they could look for, 1,316 of them, or 18.9%, were positive for SARS-CoV-2. Whereas in the fully vaccinated group, 235, or 3.1%, tested positive for SARS-CoV-2. And if you do the calculation, you'll see that in terms of preventing COVID-19 hospitalizations, the vaccines as an all group was about 86% effective at prevention. That's a relatively high number compared to what we have been seeing outside of the United States, and something that has stood up fairly well since the beginning of the year. Now, if we look at emergency room and urgent care encounters, unvaccinated visits, 10,000 to the urgent care or the emergency room, fully vaccinated, 7,000. Now, of these, how many had positive SARS-CoV-2 tests? For the unvaccinated, 28.9% did. For the vaccinated, only 7% did. And again, if we look at the efficacy in this, there was about an 82% efficacy rate in terms of prevention of these ED and urgent care visits. Let's take a look at hospitalizations once again, but let's break it down and maybe get a little bit of information as to why this is happening. So if we look at the 18 to 74, basically those less than 75. So here is less than 75 and here is greater than 75. And we break it down that way. Once again, we're going to be looking at less than 75, unvaccinated, 5,700, 4,500 for the fully vaccinated, 1,252 for the unvaccinated, and 3,125. But if we look at the percent positive for SARS-CoV-2 in those groups, in the less than 75, 21% were positive for SARS-CoV-2, and 2.9% were positive under the age of 75 for SARS-CoV-2, giving an 89% efficacy rate. That's the highest that we've seen so far in this cohort. However, when we look at those that were older than 75 or equal to 75 years of age, now notice here, this is a population that generally speaking is highly vaccinated. So we have had very good success in vaccinating many of those people in nursing homes and over the age of 75 and have gotten lots of vaccinations. And you can see here that in terms of people coming in and being hospitalized with a COVID-19-like illness, so in other words, pneumonia, things that can still happen even though you might not be getting COVID, you can see that there was a lot of admissions here in the fully vaccinated group. But when you actually tested them for SARS-CoV-2, what you start to see is that even though they're fairly similar in terms of this, so you might see this in some cases, and it was mentioned even in Israel where they'll look in the intensive care unit, they'll say there's equal number of people who are vaccinated and unvaccinated. But if you look at the number of people that have actually been admitted to the hospital for similar illnesses that you would expect to see, and because there's more people that are vaccinated in this population, you'd expect to see more of those people, you'll see that there is still a difference between this. So 10.5% of the people admitted for COVID-like illness was positive for SARS-CoV-2 and therefore positive for SARS-CoV-2 COVID-19, whereas only 3.2% in the vaccinated group was, again, giving us an efficacy rate of 76%, albeit lower than the 89%, but still in a reasonable area where we would say this would have met the criteria for emergency use authorization, even today with the Delta variant. And again, this is 7-8 months out now at this point. Most of these people who are age 75 had received their vaccine about 8 months ago. And even despite the fact that they're over the age of 75, that it's been 7 or 8 months since they've received the vaccine and they're going up against the Delta variant, we're still seeing an efficacy of 76% at preventing the worst outcome for COVID-19, which is hospitalization. But now this is where it gets interesting, because now we're going to actually break it down. And we're going to, first of all, look at the emergency room and urgent care encounters. And we're going to break it down into the Pfizer, the Moderna, and the Johnson & Johnson, or in this case, the Janssen, as it's known as, vaccine, which is the one shot. Now, in all these cases, the unvaccinated control group is going to be the same in all of those categories, because we're going up against the same in terms of that and the number of people that have been testing positive for SARS-CoV-2. And if we look at the Pfizer-BioNTech efficacy for prevention of an emergency room urgent care visit, we see it is at 77%, the Moderna is at 92%, and the Johnson & Johnson or Janssen pharmaceutical product is at 65%. And this is against Delta variant. So those are your statistics there in terms of efficacy for the vaccines in the Delta variant, the most recent evidence that we have at this time here in the United States. We'll do the same thing now for hospitalization. And that's really the key here is preventing hospitalizations, especially when we're talking about situations in some states of the union where the hospital resources have run out. This is a current situation that's going on in Idaho, but it's not limited to Idaho. There are other states that are getting to that point. They're running out of intensive care beds. And so it's important that we have a tool in our toolbox to prevent hospitalizations, especially when this is going on. Let's go over the Pfizer-BioNTech, Moderna, and Janssen vaccines. And we see here that the Pfizer-BioNTech is 80% effective at preventing hospitalization. And the Moderna is 95% effective at preventing hospitalization. And the Johnson & Johnson is 60% effective at preventing hospitalization. If you'd like to read the article yourself, we'll put the link in the description below. We recently had a chance to team up with Dr. Rhonda Patrick of Found My Fitness, where we went over very important and popular questions about the vaccine and COVID-19. So I encourage you to check that out. Thanks for joining us.